السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين، آمين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. I begin in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. الحمد لله رب العالمين. All praise are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the universe. الرحمن الرحيم, the most gracious, the most merciful. مالك يوم الدين, the owner of the day of judgment. إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. You alone we worship and you alone we seek for help. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this surah, Surah Al-Fatiha, told us and taught us how to praise Allah, how to glorify Allah, and how to beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. First thing, we start with glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, admiring Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for whatever He is and for whatever He has done for us. So the first thing the person does is he thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, alhamdulillah. Starts with thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then recognizing who his Rabb is, who Allah is, Rabbil Alameen, the Lord of the universe. And as we talked in the previous sessions, Rabb means the one who is the caretaker, provider, who fulfills all the needs. Rabb is the one who is fulfilling our needs even when we are sleeping, even when we forget Him, He doesn't forget us. And He is not just my Rabb and your Rabb, He is the Rabb of Al-Alameen, of all the universes. Of whatever exists, He is the Rabb of it. So we admire Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for whatever He is, who is Rabbul Alameen. Once we recognize who our Allah is and we say He is Rabbul Alameen, He is Rabbul Alameen, then we go into the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we need the most, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses for us the most, and that is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. The most gracious, the most merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't use His attribute of zuntiqam, of shadeedul iqab for us. He always uses this attribute of rahman, of rahmah with us. He's showering His rahmah on all of us day and night. And not only on the believers, even the kuffar are receiving the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all the times. Maliki yawm al-deen. He is the owner of the day of judgment. Once we talked about the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then there is need to remind our souls that don't be spoiled. And remember that He is just, and there is a day when we all will be judged for our deeds. So the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just like other nations took it and they used it, that God is merciful. And a lot of our people are using the very same excuse, oh, Allah is Ghafoor Rahim. No, He is Maliki Yawm al-Din, the owner of the Day of Judgment, which means, remember, a day would come that is the Day of Judgment. We will be judged for our deeds. So fear the day, any person who knows he would be judged for what he is doing, that person would be afraid and would be careful of what he is doing. If there is judgment, if the person knows he would be taken to court for this action, then he would be very careful on how he does those things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us that there is a day that is called the Day of Judgment, so you all will be judged. Remember, whatever you do in this life, there is hisab for it. There is judgment for it. And the judge will be Allah. So He is Rahman al-Rahim. That's good news. That mashallah, very merciful. So the judge is very kind-hearted. But after all, he is a judge too. Which means, there is insaf, there is adl, there is justice. It's not that just because you are Muslim, you call yourself Muslim, so you go to Jannah, don't worry about nothing. No, there is judgment, there is adl, there is justice. So we have to be careful on how we behave, how we live, what we do, because there is a Day of Judgment. And Allah is the owner of the Day of Judgment. The one who is Rahman and Rahim, who is Rabbul Alameen, who controls everything, He will be judging us. Nothing is hidden from Him. So, keeping both sides and reminding us of Allah is Rahman, Allah is Rahim, but remember, you will have to go through the judgment, so you be careful of your a'mal and of your deeds and of what you do. Maliki Yawm al-Din, the owner of the Day of Judgment. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Now we are showing our connection with Him. That Ya Allah, You alone we worship. We don't worship anyone other than You, Ya Allah. My whole ibadah is only for You. وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. But my ibadah is nothing. I need Your help, Ya Allah. I need Your help. A person who is doing the ibadah, more than looking at his ibadah, he should be looking at the one who he's doing the ibadah for. This is why, first thing, recognize him, that he is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, he is Malik Yawm al-Din, and now, Iyaka Na'bud. You alone I worship, Ya Allah. No one else deserves ibadah. So You alone we worship. And then, Wa Iyaka Nasta'een, our ibadah is nothing. So we ask You for Your help, Ya Allah. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, okay, my help is there for you. What do you need? اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Guide us to the straight path. My greatest need is, I want to be on the straight path, Ya Allah. I don't want to lose the path. This is my greatest need. Subhanallah. Rabbul Alameen is teaching us to ask Him for it. Because He knows what our needs are. If it was up to us, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, imagine if He would have stopped Surah Al-Fatiha at this point, that إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, and then the instruction would be, now you ask for whatever you think is the most important thing you need. Just think what would we would be asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what would be our need and what we would think of my greatest need. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't leave it for us because we may make a mistake. We may keep on asking for things that really are not as important as this one. So He taught us that first thing ask Allah is, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. Ya Allah, guide me to the straight path. Guide me to the straight path. And this tells us how important it is for a person to be worried about him being on the straight path. That first thing, this is my first priority that I want to ask Allah, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. And then it's not only for me, for all the people. Guide all of us, Ya Allah. This tells us the importance of collective ibadah. When ibadah is doing together, it's done together. Because it has more power to it. So ihdina, plural, guide all of us to the straight path. Once we know that, how important this straight path is, then Ya Allah, I want to make sure that I always remain on this straight path. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now, He's using a method of dua in which we are asking, but He's teaching at the same time, what is the straight path? صِرَافَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. Guide me to the path of those who were favored by you. Who are those people? Anbiya, Siddiqeen, Shuhada and Salihin. Keep me on the path of those. غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ. Not the path of those who received your anger. I don't want to be on the path of those who received your anger, Ya Allah, with whom you were angry. وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. And I don't even want to be on the path of those who went astray. Here we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking us to make this dua, which is the most important dua of our life. At the same time, is teaching us that you know what is hidayah, what is sirat al-mustaqim. Sirat al-mustaqim is the way of anbiya and sulaha and salihin. And whenever you see yourself following al-maghdubi alayhim and al-dallin, following those who are away from Allah, those who do the a'mal, the type of deeds that brings the wrath and the anger of Allah, you should know that you are falling off Sirat al-Mustaqim. No one has to tell me, no one has to tell you. It's very simple, very straight. The thing that I'm doing, is it something that Anbiya would do? Is it something that we can expect Sulaha and the virtuous people to do something like this? If not, then if I'm doing something like that, I'm not on Sirat al-Mustaqim. Very easy. All of us, we can judge ourselves. We can find it very easily. Is it something that Anbiya did it? No, Anbiya didn't do anything like this. Would any Prophet of Allah would do something like this? No. Then this is not Sirat al-Mustaqim. Don't fall in that path. Don't go in that direction. Because this is not Sirat al-Mustaqim. And as soon as we see ourselves doing the type of things that al-maghdubi alayhim and al-dallin did, those who received Allah's wrath, those who did the type of amal about which Allah says this is dalala, going astray, going away from Allah's instructions given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is dalala. A person is losing the direction. And of course, in Surah Al-Baqarah then, and other surahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would tell us, what are some of those things that made those people to become maghdubi alayhim and to become al-dallin? What are the things that bring the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Those things would come further on. But here, in simple words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that make sure you are following the ways of anbiya and sulaha. That is very important. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us that when we recite Surah Al-Fatiha, at the end of the surah, we say Ameen. What does Ameen mean? Ameen means Allahumma istajib. Ya Allah, accept my prayer. Ya Allah, accept my dua. This is what Ameen means. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned a lot of virtues for saying Ameen. In one of the ahadiths, it says that a sahabi was making dua. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if he would finish the dua properly, his dua would be accepted. His dua is guaranteed, would be accepted. So another sahabi asked, Ya Rasulullah, what does finishing properly means? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that he would say Ameen at the end. This Sahabi, subhanAllah, Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in, they loved each other. This Sahabi quickly went to the person that Sahabi was making the dua. And he says to him in his ear, make sure you say Ameen before you finish your dua. And there is a good news for you that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said your dua would be accepted. So of course that Sahabi, then as he's making dua, then at the end he says Ameen and he finishes dua and dua was guaranteed. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us every dua should finish with Ameen. And here we see that at the beginning of dua we should glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should admire Rabbul Alameen. Start with the hamd, shukr, thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah, praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is how every dua should start. A person was seen making dua after salah. A sahabi started making some dua. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَجَلْتَ أَيُّهَا الْمُصَلِّ. O you who were praying, you went too quick into making dua. Then he told him, when you make dua, first thing, thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then send blessings on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then start making the dua. And at the end of the dua, again, send blessings on Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once again. And say Ameen. This is how you make sure that your dua is accepted. So, thanking Allah at the beginning and end. Sending blessings on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the beginning and at the end. And Ameen at the end. This is how du'as are accepted. In fact, the hadith indicate that when people are making a collective du'a, one person makes the du'a and other people are saying Ameen. The ones who are saying Ameen, their du'a would be accepted for everything that they are hearing from this person. So whatever he's making dua, whatever he's saying, by saying Ameen, they are considered as if they are making that dua. So dua and Ameen is just like a seal on the dua. That now, this dua is confirmed, is sealed. And it goes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in that shape, in that form, that this is what the person is asking for. So Ameen is very important and as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, is a way of getting our dua accepted. Of course, a question then comes about, in salah, the Ameen should be said louder or in a low voice. There is difference between the fuqaha about this. And the reason the difference of opinion comes is because of the wordings that are used in the hadith. So we cannot say that this is the only way, that's the only way. There is difference of opinion between the fuqaha. And as I mentioned before also, that in this session of tafsir, I don't want to go into too much detail of the masail of fiqh. But very briefly, the reason this difference of opinion about saying Ameen comes up and a question comes that should it be said loud or low in salah is because there are ahadith that indicate Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhi wa jama'in heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying Ameen. Yes, there are ahadith that indicate to that. Then the question comes, did Sahaba say it loud behind Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or not? Now we don't find any hadith that says, or I should say authentic hadith that says Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhi wa jama'in said it loud behind Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So now, some of the fuqaha say, you know, if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said it loud, Sahaba may have said it loud. So say it loud. Others say, no, there is no proof that Sahaba said it loud behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so don't say it loud. The question is, should the Imam say it loud or not because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was heard? Again, the question comes between the fuqaha, did he always say it loud or he said it sometime? Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah, very well-known scholar, who wrote a beautiful book called Zadul Ma'ad, he says in there in his book that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sometime he said it loud ta'liman, said it loud so that people can know that would know that he says Ameen, And rest of the times he didn't say it loud. Just like people heard him recite Surah Sabbih Isma Rabbika Al-A'la in Salat Al-Dhuhr. Doesn't mean you always recite, you recite loud in Salat Al-Dhuhr. So this is where the difference of opinion comes between the fuqaha. It's all ijtihad. And we should not make it a point of differences between the ummah and dividing the ummah that, you know, you don't say Ameen loud, so now your salah is invalid and my way is the only way, and or you say because you said it louder, so you lost some reward because of saying it loud. No. And then again, one of the things that fuqaha, they consider is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ud'u rabbakum tadarru'an wa khufya. When you make the dua, try to keep it as low as possible. And now they say, Ameen is a portion of dua. Then the question comes, okay, if you say it loud, say for example, we say, okay, say it loud, then there is no hadith that says, don't say it loud in Salat al-Dhuhr and Salat al-Asr. Don't say it loud in the third and fourth rak'ah. So what should we do in that situation? Again, ijtihad. Should women say it loud or in a low voice? Again, it will be a matter of ijtihad. So there is a lot of ijtihad there. And these type of, the reason I'm mentioning this, so that we are open-minded and we understand that these are the difference of opinion between the fuqaha and whoever follows any of these fuqaha, any of the imam, mashallah, is good that is following the ijtihad of that imam. As far as to say that, you know, the hadith only supports what I'm doing and there is no reason, all of those people, they don't understand, they don't know what they're doing, that's very bad and that's wrong. And this is the thing that really divides people. That, you know, those people don't know it. They're doing it only because they follow imam. No, it's not that. Because there are hadith and there is ijtihad over there. So this is where that difference of opinion comes about, saying Ameen in salah, loud or in a low voice. As I said, Surah Al-Fatiha is an introduction to the whole Qur'an. And it has the gist of the whole Qur'an. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ is showing our connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and at the same time is teaching us the oneness of Allah. That we, you alone we worship. So it shows that we are keeping ourselves from all kind of shirk and kufr. We worship and you alone we worship. We worship is that we are safe from kufr. And you alone we worship, we are safe from shirk. We don't associate no partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ tells us that when we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not only that we don't have any partners to Allah in ibadah only, we don't have partners with Allah within anything. Even when it comes to asking for help, I ask Allah for help. And we talked about the ruling of asking for help, that it doesn't mean we cannot ask each other for help and no one can help each other. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ Help each other in birr, in doing good. So asking each other's help and looking for each other's help and seeking the help from other people is fine, as long as we don't consider those people to be the doers of things. We consider Allah to be the doer of everything, but we ask each other for help. وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. As we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for hidayah, now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving us the book of hidayah. He's now teaching us what is hidayah. So it starts, Alif Lam Mim, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ Alif Lam Mim, this is the book in which there is no doubt. It's a guidance for the people of taqwa. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين والمسلمات وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.